Hi guys, today we're at the Classica Refugium near Stuttgart. Not far away from here, it's probably one of the best kept places in the automotive sector, the Porsche Development Center in Weissach. And as you can see in the background, today we're going to give you a special insight into the heart of it, the Porsche Design Studio. We will unveil exclusively some studies that have been well kept secrets up to now. So here's a little sneak peek for, stay tuned for our Porsche Talk Unseen. This is a very good moment to unveil our first model because technology plays also a big role at this design study. It actually prevented this study from being developed further, but I think you have more details. So let's unveil our first design study, the Porsche 919 Street. So here is the beauty, and I think you can give us some more details about.
Yeah, as I said, when we talk about studies for the future, it's the idea is always to travel really 30, 50 years ahead and see what is possible and then going back, and that influences what we are doing today. And the starting point can always be very different. In that case, it was the starting point was the decision from Porsche to leave the Le Mans series, this LMP1 technology, which from the Porsche technology was extremely successful, was existing. And the idea there was, can we do a kind of street legal version based on that technology? And therefore, as you mentioned, the technology was existing. So the freedom in a way was limited, but then we were building around this car. And what is always our intention, that these models then are a starting point for discussion in the company, if it would make sense to realize this, to bring it on the street. And in that special case, it was as well the technology then was in the end avoiding to bring it to the road, because this racing technology is so complicated and highly complex that it would be would have been hard to give it really into customer hands.
According to brain scientist Gerhard Roth, 80% of the people are change averse. That means simply that they don't like changes. And you have the master task not only to find the balance between habits and necessary further development, but also you're not allowed to change anything which is connected to the DNA of Porsche and, of course, to the model. So can you tell us something about the non-touchable parts of the design of Porsche?
Yeah, again, this is if we compare projects like production car projects, where we really have, based on our design principles or design criteria, we have certain things described that we basically don't touch. If we talk about this kind of visions for the future, since we go so far into the future, there are basically no conventions, there are no restrictions. Everything can be questioned. And by having this freedom, again, we collect some experiences that then might influence on the our view on the current products. But it is to find this balance, to build up this tension between the history, the elements, the design language is based on, and the task and the challenge to further develop it So maybe that's really the most challenging part of my task, yeah.
But there are new things happening, and with the Taycan, the new sport cars era in an electric way came up. So what remained from the Porsche DNA still in the Taycan?
Yeah, I mean, the Taycan as well, let's say the car as it looks like, in a way, had as well its origin in one of the studies. But it started as a completely different car with a completely different technology. So we did just a, let's say, super sports car with four seats, but it would have been hard to realize this with the performance customers expect from Porsche. So then a couple of years later, we pulled it out again and said, as a proportion, as an architecture, that would be nice for being the first electrical car. But we knew as well that the design language was not modern enough. And then we looked at other studies that had been much further in the future, and took elements from these studies and applied it to, at that time it was called the 960 Turismo, into this Mission E show car and then in the Taycan. So again, it is, sometimes it's just a design element, sometimes it's the whole architecture and proportion, but again, if you don't go into so far into the future, you won't have this, let's say, findings, and you won't have this experience.
Yeah, but you always have to work in the future because you design those future cars. How long do you take from the first sketch to the market-ready model?
One of the last secrets of the car industry.
Yeah, we're going to reveal today everything, literally. Yeah.
So, again, it depends as well on the characteristic of the project. I used to say the really intensive time in the design department is 1.5 years. But if you, and then it's a question, when do you start to count and when is really the start of production? But I used to say whenever we present a new production car to the public, the new 911, then in a way it's almost an old timer for the designer because we already started to work on the next generation.
So you started to work on the Taycan years ago, and let's say if you started more than 7 years ago, it was very quiet on the electric market, at least at the customer's side or on the customer's side. But you really hit the bull's eye with the Taycan. So how do you get the feeling for the upcoming spirit and the time ahead?
I think that's again the beauty of that. We as designers get this freedom to go so far into the future, where I think it's as well a great sign of confidence in our work that the board members or the CEO, Olli Blume, just gives us a budget without knowing really what will be the result. But since we have done this, as I said, with the Taycan, we were then, when the decision was taken to go into this electrical world, we were much faster because years before we had already found an architecture that we believed then is very well applicable to this new generation. Again, this going into the day after tomorrow and then go around there, develop scenarios and concepts, then do studies like this, even as physical models, as a base for a discussion. And with this findings that change your state of mind, and with this you go back to tomorrow. I think that's one of the keys for the success of the Porsche brand.
Hi guys, today we're at the Classica Refugium near Stuttgart, not far away from here. It's probably one of the best kept places in the automotive sector, the Porsche Development Center in Weissach. And as you can see in the background, today we're going to give you a special insight into the heart of it, the Porsche Design Studio. We will unveil exclusively some studies that have been well kept secrets up to now. So here's a little sneak peek for, well, no. Stay tuned for our Porsche Talk Unseen. To have you here. Hi, Stefan.
Hi.
You were involved in that project from the very first moment. So tell us something. How did that project came about and how much persuasion did you have to put into it to convince the people that it's a good idea to show all those insights into the sacred halls of the design studio?
Well, the birth of Unseen was while taking pictures already of some cars. And I know the Porsche brand through the 356, through the 911, through the race cars, Boxster, of course. And there's so much more going on in Weissach. I would call it the Weissach vibe. And there was a simple question while we had some good coffee at your studio. Why don't we show it to the public? A very easy question, actually. So that's how it started.
So you created a hashtag for right now, the Weissach vibe, very cool. But Michael, I have to ask you that. How many calls did you have to make to convince your colleagues and all the other guys in your office to say, yeah, that's a good idea, let's show it to the audience?
That's another secret, not of the car industry, that's my secret. There were some, let's say, talks, meetings, because it's very unusual for the car industry to show this secret stuff to the public.
Yeah, but we're so happy that you decided to do that, actually. And now we come to our next revelation moment. And I think we can lift here that. And I just tell the people that this is the Porsche Vision Spider. And maybe, Michael, you can tell us, what is the basic idea of this design study?
Yeah, again, always different starting points, but as well, based on the discussions during our espresso meetings, it's always this smaller, puristic, reduced car where basically the Porsche brand took its start. That's always something we are dealing with in that special case. And we have done different models. In that special case, it was all about trying to build up a relation to a historic car, the 550. And that was then the inspiration. And we took some elements like the painting or how the fenders are done. We took this inspiration from the back.
From the past, from the James Dean past. I see the sparkle in the eyes and I hand over to you, Stefan.
Yeah, I just, it's very nice. This car means a lot to me because I just do a book about the 550 Spider for 2 years already. And we just drove two cars on the Alpine road. It's such a fantastic small car. And that's, I think, the DNA of Porsche is small and powerful and light, and this car reflects it perfectly. You know, it's just, it's not big, it's very small. It has all the little details from the 550, like the back here, the fender. You know, it's called Little Rebel, you can't see. You see all the air intakes. Of course, the color blocking, silver, red, is so nice. So it's just, I think, a perfect new interpretation of the 550, of the legend.
I want to jump in with a question, because I know your magazine from very cool cars on a curvy road, but now you have here a static car in a clean environment. How difficult was it to take those cool and fancy pictures?
Very easy.
Yeah,
it was. The design was so exciting.
You can't say anything different, I know.
Of course, I like them driving more, but the cars are so beautiful. The concept was taking pictures at their birthplace. You know, we just had 20 meters around the studio to take pictures. But, you know, everybody who sees that car, even not moving, imagines his own picture. One is like, drives somewhere in around San Francisco. The other mind is somewhere in the Alpine Road. So it's okay to not drive it.
So, Michael, the origin idea or the origin car you looked at was the 550 of James Dean. So what impressed you most and inspired you most of that car back then?
Yeah, you know, in general, if we do a design, one thing is just the surface treatment and the design. But we always want to express let's say, influence the fantasy of customers that look at the car. And I mean, again, James Dean as an actor with the 550, I mean, this is really an experience at itself. And as a designer working for Porsche, you have to look back to that car, because it's not just the shape of the car, it's everything that you, let's say, connect with this. And we wanted to bring all of this feeling, even though none of the designer who worked on this was born at that time back there. But that was the idea, to bring this into the design of that car, that when people look at it, no matter if it's driving or standing around, that you immediately have all these pictures in your mind.
Maybe you can show us some details here, what is very interesting from your designer perspective.
Yeah, again, what I said, I mean, first of all, and as Stefan mentioned, it's a small, very compact car, which is really a challenge. We were talking about technologies with today's technology, so very compact. Then as well, details where we wanted to introduce new design elements, for example, this headlamp. I mean, the 550 Spider had these round headlamps. So that could be maybe the next evolution of that headlamp. Then, as we said, with this color scheme, subtle hints to the past. Then on the back again, it is the treatment of the surface, the tension that is in these surfaces, is typical Porsche, is the modern characteristics. But again, with some elements, you can easily see the connection to this 550 Spider. And that's how we try to do things, even when we look back into history, that it is not a replica, but it's a modern interpretation of the theme back there.
So Stefan, if I allowed you to take just one picture of a detail of the car, what would you choose?
I would choose the back.
Again.
Yeah, again, the back. I love this detail. You know, it's of course something Porsche lovers like, you know, because they know what this means. Yeah. So I'm going for this line.
Okay.
And Michael, you've been a chief designer at Porsche since 2004. That makes you only the third chief designer after Ferdinand Alexander Porsche, and he is well known as a functionalist. So yeah. Do you have that spirit always in your mind when you design cars and even when you test things with your design studies?
We try hard, and I think whenever you have a car or a brand like Porsche, when cars has this performance, you even have to stick to the functionality, because an air intake has a function. Either it's cooling from the engine, from the brakes, or it's aerodynamics. So I think we very much live this culture and try to give each and every detail a function. But as I said as well, even the design itself has the function to excite people.
Stefan, what was your first thought when you saw that car the first time?
Wow. Very easy, actually. Yeah. Yeah, drive it right now.
All right. So at the end, I want to know, because it's a design study, which information did you take out of it to use it for other design studies? Or was it just like, oh gosh, this was a playground for designers and it was so cool, but we can't use anything of it?
So that was definitely the case, that we had a lot of fun working on this. It shows that we as designers have a very good idea how we can further develop the design language, the surface language. We showed as well that a small car could be very attractive. And as I mentioned with the headlamps, even in the details, there will be a lot of inspiration for future products. Still as a designer, you always hope and keep your fingers crossed that your ideas once hit the road.